Well, as Fran said, the important thing here is that most of the things that I'm going to talk about today is going to be very short, very condensed, perhaps, so I hope that I make myself explain well. It's going to be about specific kinds of arrangements that is some specific social networks have, in particular organizational networks, but that replicate a hierarchical arrangement that is pervasive to other kinds of network structures. So I would like that you just, if you ever face the need to study networks, functional networks, for example, you bear this thing in mind, because they are known to display also a hierarchical arrangement between the different zones. So, network science in general is an interdisciplinary approach. It encompasses several disciplines. Physics is one of them, computer science is another. Biology is very important there, social sciences, and all of them have brought together different kinds of tools and approaches to network data. Network data is something that appears in systems composed by many elements, brain is one of them, that are obviously interconnected. And then what we want to see is which are the emergent properties of these systems, which are the emergent properties that these systems have because of the interconnectivity that they have. What is very important is that whenever you find a kind of arrangement in one of these disciplines, most likely the kinds of approaches, the kind of things that you can deduct from them is or can be also readily applied to the other disciplines. That's why it is very interesting as a research, from a research point of view. And I'm going to talk about something specific here, that is one typical property of networks, and in particular of the nodes of the networks, that is their centrality. The fact that the importance of nodes is given by some quantitative measure with respect to the position that they occupy in the network is something that was recognized already decades ago. Social scientists know these things since the 40s. Other disciplines learned it later. And basically, centrality is a measure, typically node-based. So each node in the network, each constituent in the network is endowed with a value of centrality. And how you can measure this centrality vastly depends on which is the fact around centrality that you want to highlight. A typical thing, just that you have something in mind, is computing the number of connections that a node has within the network, and the more connected it is, the more central you assume this node to be. This is the simplest thing, that is just computing what is called the degree. There are others that, for example, say how many paths go through specific nodes, and this is the betweenness centrality, that this explains that a node is central if it allows different regions of the networks to be connected to each other. And you have many. In fact, this periodic table of centralities is not a joke, but something that someone took the time to build upon the different notions of centrality that you can have. So the question that you have is, how do you make sense of all of this when you want to study specific things of centrality? And the answer is, well, depending on the context, you will have a tool specifically that's going to specifically address your question. The important thing is that all the notions that are here are global. They somehow encode the global properties of the network in a measure for each node. But I'm going to talk about something else that is, you will see this link to this notion of centrality, this network nestedness, that is a kind of hierarchical organization that networks display. What is it? Let me start from the most basic thing. Whenever you have a network, you can build out of it an adjacency matrix, that is, one if there is a connection between pair of nodes, or zero if there is not such a connection. So, for example, between nodes 2 and 3, there is a link here, so the position 2, 3 has a 1, however, 2, 5 has a 0 because there is no connection between these two nodes. Okay, this translates into a 0 here. The simplest way of showing this network is pixelating it. the simplest way in which you can have a visual representation of this is creating a bitmap where you have black dots in the positions of this adjacency matrix where there are edges and zero otherwise. Why I'm doing that? Because in order to understand what is nestedness, there is an intermediate step that is, this is the simplest hierarchical structure of this star network in which there is a single node that is connected to everybody else, and all the others are only connected to this central node. This is a star, and it looks like this when you display it in terms of an adjacency matrix, and you sort the nodes by degree. That is the number of connections. And this structure has always this shape. This is basically the thing that you have to bear in mind. It is a hierarchical organization in which the following thing happens. If for every pair of nodes, I and J, the fact that the number of neighbors that node I has, for example, this one, is larger than the number of networks that node J has, for example, this one, this implies that the neighborhood, so the, all the set of nodes that are neighbors of I, contain the set of neighbors of the node J. There is a very simple example here. Let us take these two pair of nodes. The yellow row has a larger set of neighbors than the blue one, and you see that all the neighbors, except for itself, because the diagonal is itself, so you can discard it, but all the other neighbors of this node are contained, sorry, all the neighbors of this node are contained in the neighborhood of this node. And this is true for any pair of nodes that you take. It is true for this one, for this one, for this one. When for every pair of nodes I and J, this condition is verified, you will have something that is called a stepwise adjacency matrix, and because if there is a region that is completely black, there is a region that is completely white, and this is a nested network. It has specific properties. The most important thing is that it is a very strong core periphery structure that talks about a hierarchical network because all these nodes that are in the core are connected to each other. That's why this submatrix is fully connected. And all the nodes outside are only connected to the core. So which is a typical signature of hierarchical organization. What happens is that the more edges violate the property of nestedness, the less nested the structure is, until you reach a point in which there is not such a subregion that is fully nested, that is inside of this stepwise region, and then the nodes, the more violations you have of this condition, the less nested the structure is and the more random it is. Why I'm saying this? Because in real data, obviously, you will not have such a clean network structure. What is interesting is that when you start analyzing networks and those that are largely hierarchical, I'm going to give some examples here, you find this property in many cases. Here, the first network that I am showing is the World Trade Network, in which nodes are countries and there are connections between them if there were trade relations of imports and exports in a particular year. This is a similar network, but built only for countries that sell weapons to other nations. And you also see the same kind of phenomenon. These are trade networks. This is a completely different one. This is a network of R&D alliances. R&D is research and development. And you see that there exist some nodes that are completely central to the network. They are connected to everybody else. They have alliances to everybody else. And some others that are peripheral, that are those that are, in fact, these ones that are loosely connected, but they are also connected to the central nodes. This is Bank of Settlements, the Fedwire. This is also the Interbank Austrian interbank network for loans between banks. And all of them show the same kind of property. These are some other toys examples. This is more in the line of what I'm going to tell you in a second, that is communications within organizations. In communications within organizations, it's very interesting because you have individuals in the organization that are completely central, that connect to everybody else, and others that only connect to these central nodes. The role of these central nodes, the ones that are very largely connected, this is a very small data set, and this is a larger manufacturing company. You see that these, what are around 10 people that communicate with everybody else in the company, and all the others only communicate to them. Okay? If you look at them in this way, basically you have people routing all the communication within the company, and others that mostly communicate to the people in the core. And the people in these companies, in general, are people that are from the administrative services, because they are the routing ones in the system. This is a much larger organization. Here we went from 33 individuals, 70, and this is 200. And you see that there is a kind of shadow of nestedness, if you allow me. But I'm going to go back to this example later. Remind here that, in contrast with these two, here there are many organizational units that make the problem completely different. So what we did is, I will not go into many details about this model, but what we started was a model in which agents attempt to maximize their centrality, because this is what gives them larger payoff inside of in the long run. So and they can maximize their centrality by changing their local neighbor. So that this implies that they can select someone else to connect to. Also, we assume that these links have a finite lifetime, so they decay over time. No reason to go into the details of the model, but the important thing is that when you analyze this system, and we were able to solve it formally, the best strategy for an agent, if he has to create a link, is to connect the node with the largest centrality he's still not connected to. If an agent has to be removed, also you can show that the links that first decay are those that have the smallest centrality. What is interesting out of this is that, regardless of the initial condition, if the agencies are strategic enough, let me say, if they are able to evaluate these processes enough, always the network evolution converges towards a nested structure, always. When we did this, you see that I was really loose here, because when I started talking, I said they want to maximize their centrality. But in the first slide, I showed you a periodic table with 100 different centrality measures. So what is this? What are you talking about now? Which exactly centrality are you referring to here? Well, centrality, when we analyzed this, we took the most paradigmatic measures of centrality. And what is interesting is that in nested networks, these most common measures of centrality are always ranked like degree, which is important because I told you that centrality is a global property. So how does an agent know the global properties of the network such that he's able also to foresee to exactly calculate the centrality of someone else in the network is something difficult. However, computing the degree of someone is not very difficult because you only need local information. Basically, you can get this information by asking one friend of yours who is a really popular guy you know. This is basically a way in which you can guess the degree. It's just local. So, the kind of dynamics I told you about convergence, and I told you that one thing that I didn't say is that the dynamics does not depend exclusively on the initial condition. So let me start from a completely empty network. Okay? I told you that the best thing that one can do is to connect to someone that is very central or the most central that's not connected to. So if it is an empty network, this means connecting to someone at random. Now, someone else is going to receive an opportunity to create a link. Most likely thing, if all of the agents can be chosen at random, most likely thing is that one of these guys are going to be selected to create a connection. And what they do? Well, what they would like to do is connect to someone that is already inside of the network. So for them, the next thing that's going to happen, whoever you try to connect here, the next step in the network evolution is going to be this one. Now, something... nothing particular you would say happened. Well, in fact, something very special happened. And it's the fact that you have just broken the symmetry in the system. Suddenly, you have now an agent that is this first node that is more connected than anybody else in the network. Now, when someone else is selected to create a new link, it's most likely going to be one of all these guys that is still disconnected, because this will happen with a, if it is a uniform probability, this is 5/8, so still the most likely thing is that one of these guys is going to be selected. Now, whoever wants to select the new connection partner are going to select the first guy, because he has already two neighbors, whereas the second one has only one. So the next step is here, and suddenly everybody else that wants to create a new connection will always select this guy. So right out of a completely uniform initial distribution, you end up a process by which agents select the most central, and by doing so just reinforce the centrality of the central agent. What is important is that this kind of dynamics always preserves the property of nestedness, and you will see now, again, in the context of organizational networks, what happens. In general, once you enter into an organization, you are told who are the person you should refer to when you want for information. So, what happens is that the person that knows most of the things is the one that immediately receives connections from everybody else. When the organization grows, what happens is that this person has limited capacity constraints, so this person is not able to route all the possible messages that are inside of the system. So what happens is that someone else starts to gather information, also from, in general, from administration, and to route part of the information. Some of the traffic that was for this guy eventually is rerouted to this one who starts to reroute. And then everybody else starts to recognize that this is someone else that they can refer to if they need to reroute some of the messages. And this is how the second largely connected person appears in the system. This is something that you can see in a very fast simulation that I'm going to show you. This is basically, So what happens is that here you have random connections. If you don't have this nested structure, the only thing that you have is random connections between the individuals. But once you allow them to compute a little bit better the strategic behavior that they can have, you see that suddenly, from this state, suddenly a star system appears, I see here, in which suddenly you saw that the transition was abrupt. Suddenly, all of them create someone that is very central. But everybody else created this person central. And by doing so, everybody else in the system becomes peripheric. And it is much harder for them to climb the hierarchy. If you keep decreasing this level of randomicity, you see that more and more nodes are well connected in the system. This is basically the mechanism. Good, so remember this, that what is interesting here in this kind of model is that the actions of the agents are those that reinforce the structure that you have just seen. And that agents become central not because they have a much better strategic behavior than everybody else, but simply because everybody else selects them to be central, and by doing so, they reinforce the hierarchical structure. Therefore, the more agents strive to maximize their centrality in the network, the more difficult it is, in fact, for them, if they are peripheric, to climb within the social hierarchy. So the nice thing about this, closing this chapter, is the fact that all these kind of measures have encode local properties, global properties, sorry. The important thing is that when you have nested structures, all these centrality measures have exactly the same ranking. So the exact notion of centrality of what the agents are trying to maximize is completely irrelevant for the dynamics that I have just described, and that is a general phenomenon. I talked a lot about organizational networks where the model, the applicability of the model is very simple. There are a kind of networks, this you can call unipartite, because all the nodes that you have inside of the network are of the same nature. This is a different kind of network. There are other kind of networks that I studied mostly in ecology, for example, that are bipartite. Bipartite because you have two kinds of nodes, and one node can only be connected to some other node of the other kind. In the example here, the typical example that ecologists do of these networks are mutualistic networks. Mutualistic networks are those in which you have, for example, plants, flowering plants, you have pollinators, bees, insects, and you have a connection between the plants and the bees if this bee pollinates this plant. Okay? The fact, when you show the agency matrix of these interactions, what it is possible to see, you will see it in the next slide, is this one. You see that it shows a large degree of nestedness. What is interesting is that when you do the same analysis, for example, in information retrieval, here is a network of Twitter, in which here you have agents, and here you have hashtags. And you have a link between them if this user used that hashtag. You also see that there is a nested structure within this system. This also happens between cities and services in a particular region of the city and the geographical location of the city, extent of species in particular islands within archipelagos, where you have islands here and which is the species that are in that are present in the island, and so on and so forth. This is very pervasive phenomenon in bipartite networks, and therefore ecologists mainly have developed a lot of techniques to identify when the degree of nestedness that you have in these matrices is statistically significant or not. I'm not going to talk about this. The important thing is that these kind of things that I showed to you before, if you also face bipartite networks, are also present there with a similar translation. But I want to, before closing, I want to go back to this multi-department organization I showed to you before. You see that here, whether the level of nestedness in this network is real or not is a matter of a large debate, even if you have null models. What is important is that when you really analyze the data, one thing that we recognized lately, and that we are finishing a paper exactly about this now, is the fact that you can do something different. That is, looking at the interconnections between the different units in this organization. And what you see is that locally, actually, there is the emergence of a local hierarchical organizations, local nested structures within this units. This is not an artifact only of the fact we have these techniques to identify this kind of hierarchical arrangements was not present before. In fact, it's very interesting that you also see shadows of nestedness as well in the off-diagonal elements. You see, but what is interesting is that the techniques to unravel this kind of processes was not present before. And we were able to identify that even in ecological systems, this is the case. And you could say, if you know a little bit of network science, you could say, well, but this is more or less the concept of modularity that is present in networks, but it is not because of the initial idea that modularity has, that is the fact of having bunches of nodes well bounded to each other, and loosely connected to nodes in other networks. Here, in other modules. Here, what you have is hierarchical organization within each module. Hierarchical organization with each module, like these ones. And this is exactly the kind of structure that you are able to identify by this method. But this is still, these kind of interactions are very little understood. But you have to remind the perhaps one of the most important things in this kind of interconnected systems, that they are not usually isolated. in these particular examples of ecosystems, you have species that somehow interact also with, because they are not bounded by the region in which you're analyzing the data. They are spread all around. So how they actually interact is something that, and how many of these interactions you are going to be able to identify, depends on your scale of observation. The broader you go, the larger is the structure and the more interconnected these hierarchical structures become. I think that with this I close. Thank you very much.
Do we have time for
questions?
Yes.
Okay, start. So, I mean, you nicely showed how nestedness emerges in social networks. When I think about the brain, I think one of the key features of the brain network is redundancy.
Mm-hmm.
So, if you think, for example, about patients, half of the brain is missing, but they still function fairly normal. So, I'm wondering, is redundancy in a network, does it contradict nestedness? Intuitively, I would say nestedness is not good for redundancy. Is that correct?
Well, yes and no, because you see that one thing that it's a good question. I don't know, I don't have an answer. However, if you look at this network, and let me show you this network. One thing that nested networks have a lot, in fact, is resilience, in the sense that when you remove any node, basically the structure of the matrix remains the same. Because, I don't know if this is covering you.
Yeah, I can see. Yeah, I can see.
So, imagine that you remove even the most central node, that is this one, okay? I end up having this agency matrix. Basically, the agency matrix looks the same. You see that here redundancy is in terms of this node is redundant together with this one. All the central nodes are somehow the nodes that are bringing redundancy to this system. But I don't know how this is going to look in a brain network. I'm just arguing that nested networks, if they are not very sparse, they are really redundant, because it's also what happens in ecology. In ecology, it's not that because you removed one of the species of bees, all the system collapses. It's because you have one species that basically, if it is central enough to the system, it is covering a ecological niche pretty much like some others. It is competing also with others. So you have also redundancy there. That's why even if you remove a species, you would still have some kind of stability in the.
So if it doesn't if nestedness doesn't contradict redundancy,
so.
Then basically you're also saying, implying that you could cut out the administrative level of large companies and that would still run smoothly.
No, exactly. What I'm saying, no, is that you have to replace it with
you
someone else.
You have to replace
else.
It, okay, so it has to be re-merged.
Exactly, yeah,
okay,
absolutely. Don't quote me saying that.
Okay. Yeah, so immersion to brain, so from the structure perspective, we know it's a obvious kind of small worldedness.
Mm-hmm.
So, kind of related to the modularity on a local scale, then has long integrative properties. So would you relate it? Would you be kind of in relation to the hierarchical?
It's a good question.
Very last.
This property of small world property is also present here. You see that because of the structure of nestedness, the typical average path length between any pair of nodes is very low. It's, in fact, it's smaller than two in general, because you are always connected through a hub to someone else. Because this guy is basically the fact that you have a star, someone very very well connected, implies that you will have always a very short path with you, with anybody else, and also that you have very large clustering. And the large clustering is introduced by the central core. So nestedness implies also small world property. But I don't want to stretch. I would really like to see an analysis, because I was trying to search in the literature these days,
mm-hmm.
homework, the program here, but I couldn't find anybody studying from this perspective brain functional networks. Although they claim that they have hierarchy, I know that they have this small world, they also have this scale-free phenomenon. So,
yes, yeah, the criticality of
absolutely. So,
yeah. But that's in the functional stuff, I'm not so sure. But when we're talking structural connectivity,
exactly.
Kind of problem, that's
exactly.
That's
but then the question is that you have all the ingredients to have this kind of structure, but I never So someone studying it from this perspective.
Okay, so I can
give
you some paper.
Yeah.
Very interesting talk. Thank you very much. I think I'm going to switch to social sciences now. I mean, this seems quite interesting and after a fashion easy, because in social sciences or in ecology, you have a very clear sense of what exactly is a node. It's like a person.
Absolutely.
Or like an animal. Whereas in the brain, I mean, the most logical way to decide what a node would be in the brain would be the neuron. But we can't really measure, especially not the human brain at that level. So what? How would you decide if you have this like network, which you know is interconnected? How would you decide at what level to like segregate it into nodes? Because, for instance, in the brain, if you try to do it topologically, it might make sense for deep brain nuclei and so on. But especially on the cortex, it becomes very weird. Would it then not be better to define a node as like the GABAergic neurons and the node as like the serotonergic neurons, independently of topology? Like, how exactly would you decide how best to parcelate the brain into nodes? Or perhaps you don't have experience with the brain, but
I understand it's an epistemological problem, the one that you're... So it is a general aspect on which is the level of aggregation where... Basically, the question that you are asking is, where all this bunch of units representing my system with all this bunch of units stops being informative to me. And the only thing that I would say is that in network science, in the last couple of years, there is a trend to study from if you are familiar with time series analysis, you have all these things of information theory, entropy, entropy rate, and so on. The question here is asking, basically this, there are new techniques that allow you to compute how much information you gain by, because this is exactly the problem. I'm thinking aloud. The problem is, what you want to do is to basically create a module out of a lot of information that you deem redundant, and that this new description of reality, your new model, is one in which you basically still have the same explanatory power that you would have if you have all the billions of neurons that you have in the system. So what there are information theory approaches that basically tell you which is the... When you want to study a particular phenomenon, which is the... amount of information that you need, in particular, it is called the minimum description length of your encoding of your system. And then what you want is something that has a very small minimum description length, so that you encode very well, because you, in order to describe your system, this minimum description length is how many bits do you need in order to describe all your system. And you want that something that is very small, that you need to describe in a very small number of bits, but that has a lot of explanatory power of whatever you want to see on the other side. And now there are techniques that tell you basically how you create modules out of a bunch of nodes, and how much of the output of the system you can still explain with this reduced system. I think that this is the only kind of technique that I know that was developed recently. And it is based on information theory. And basically what you do is, later, you can compare things like, for example, maximum likelihood estimation and these kind of things on some relevant global properties that you have in the system. And then basically what you do is, you stream information, you create a smaller system, so it is shorter, and then you see how much it is explaining of the like it did with all the elements.
So you could apply this to like a time series of like brain voxel data in the same way in which
that's a good question. No, obviously the technique is not developed to do that,
okay.
But you could do exactly that. Yeah.
Okay.
Because it is general. This approach is general, but it's still in development. I don't think that such a thing exists. Exactly because of what you said. In fact, you simplified a little bit. Thank you very much. Life in social sciences is not so easy. For example, detecting modules inside of communities is something that is always prone to errors, because the testing communities in general is, you want to see, I have all these social network, I have Facebook, and I want to see which is the people that is interacting with each other. And then I want to identify the communities there. All the, this problem is anti-complete. You cannot do it in... you can only have algorithms to try to give you some representation. And you are never true. You are never sure of how you are allocating the individuals to the community is a correct assignment. So you also have this kind of fuzzy boundaries. And in order to resolve this problem, that is exactly what you are saying now. How do I create my mesoscale representation out of the micro? You will also have a fuzzy boundary there that there is no way you can resolve it.
Mm-hmm. Maybe related to this, how is it computationally? Is it computationally tracked? I mean, if I think about boxes, then we talk about 1,000 nodes or so, mm-hmm. and then they're connected. I think that's feasible even if it's NP complete. But if on the level of neurons, for example, when we're dealing with billions, so then computationally it's interesting. What is the current limit, kind of? What can you estimate roughly?
Well, you can do feasible. You have quite sophisticated community detection algorithms that can process millions of nodes with some effort, but millions, I'm not talking about billions, because they grow, they do not scale very bad with the system size. Most of them, all the quadratic dependency has been resolved a long time ago. Now it grows with the number of edges or number of links linearly or n log n, worst case. So they scale quite well. But this, the kind of techniques that I was talking about with the minimum description length do not scale so well. The others are just heuristics that allow you more or less to assign very well the communities, and then you can play from there. However, I think that there has to be a way of, you can use this simple assignment in communities that you did at the first level and see how much descriptive power you have later. This thing you can still do. But you cannot use the full artillery of the techniques. Yeah.
Okay.
Maybe one more. Just coming back to the nestedness. So that was for a binary networks. I was wondering, if you were to give weights to the connections, would the nestedness say, or would once you simulate the network, would it prefer strong connections, strong but fewer connections, or more but less?
Mm-hmm. In fact, if you see these networks, all these networks are weighted, in fact, because World Trade here, we simplified it by saying that if there existed an economic transaction between the two countries, we just paint it black. However, the important thing here is perhaps the amount of economic transactions is playing an important role there, and in fact, it is playing also it here. I am really puzzled. Here, you know that in the North of Zurich, there is someone that is an expert also on nestedness in ecologic networks, that is Jordi Vascomte. He basically invented the field. But the nice thing about these, how the ecologists collect this data is unbelievable, because you know that they go to the field, this is my area, they start to see all the insects and they just take notes for years. That's why it is so impressive that they... But the question that I have now is, how often do you have to see a bee sitting on a floor in order to be it's statistically significant? This is a good question. in fact, what they do is also if they count how many of these interactions have seen, and they also weight it and threshold it. Mm-hmm. So, in general, what you see is that the most relevant interactions are those that are inside of this region. And you still find statistical significance there. And to say the truth, part of the literature thinks that in fact this problem is part of the literature. One paper, two, and films, I don't want to say. But there are a couple of papers that say that in fact this problem is ill-defined, that what you have to do is really study the weight of the case. However, the nested structure still survives even in that case. Yeah. Any questions? Well, thank you very much then for...
Thank you.